on the next Roseanne Show.
I cannot do this show without giving homage to the hardest working women on the planet, the domestic goddess.
Two goddesses plucked from domestic obscurity.
Miss Edith, you're going to Rome. Karen, start packing because you are going to Hawaii.
On the next Roseanne Show, find out who will be the new domestic goddess.
Again today, didn't we? We separated the women from the men. I love that. I love that. Well, I love you too. Well, we have such a great show. You're lucky to be here today. I am going to the ice rink over there with national figure skater champion Michelle Kwan. Cool. To do a little bit of stuff on the ice. Today, we're also going to surprise our new domestic goddess. You're not going to want to miss her story. And right down the hall from here, national champion skater Michelle Kwan is practicing on the ice for her Disney TV special. I'm going to go check her out.
I'm good.
How are you?
I'm good. Thank you.
Thanks for letting us come over. How come you're rehearsing? Can't you just like walk on stage 5 minutes before the show starts after all you've done?
I wish I could, you know, but everybody thinks, you know, since I can do the triple lutz, triple flip, that I can do it all the time. But I have to work on it and train to get it right all the time.
But how many hours do you have to get out there on the ice and like practice to do this hour special? How many hours a day?
I'd say 5-6 hours a day.
Man.
I don't work as hard as the chorus and the cast, the rest of the cast.
They have to work harder than you because they have to be in sync.
I'm just alone skiing, so I can have my own time.
You don't get to eat donuts or ice cream or anything like that when you're training, right? Do you get to do any cool stuff like that?
I do.
You do?
I love ice cream.
I'm just always interested in what athletes eat, drink, think.
Drink,
sleep. Yeah, because it's so foreign to me, not being, not having any of that background. Like, okay, when you're out there on the ice and you're doing all those, maybe you'll show us some sow cows and stuff like that, you know, triple lutzes.
Everybody loves a sow cow. I think it's the name, sow cow.
Yeah, the name. Everyone likes rhymes. But now when you're out there, you know, and you're competing or whatever, and you do it and you fall, what does that do? How hard is that to come back into the... Doesn't it break your concentration?
It does.
How hard is it to come back?
You have to practice. And sometimes when you fall in practice, you have to get back right back up and continue with the music.
Right.
See, the music...
How do you get your head to be able to, like, accommodate a mistake and come back and spring back?
That's the hardest part.
That'd be the hardest part of training, right?
Yeah, when you make a mistake, you're usually like, oh, I don't want... You don't want to do the next
thing.
Yeah,
because you feel bad and it throws you.
Yeah, but in competition, you can't go, stop the music, I want to do it over.
How do you get the will together to just get up and keep going?
You try to forget what happened.
Immediately, though.
Yeah,
you
have to, like, shut it off and say, okay, next thing, think about that, land that jump. You know, you can't be like, oh, I fell.
Sometimes you
mess up the next thing.
Sometimes you can see where it... like throw somebody so bad that they can't regain their composure. But other times you can see it as
in one year in nationals, I fell once and it just threw my whole program out of sync. and the rest of the program I was
Yeah. See, it's like that for comics too, because like if a joke doesn't go over, you know, it's hard to come back after something fails.
Yeah, it kind of, it makes you stop and you're like, okay, you can't regain the momentum that you had before, you know?
Is it hard too to like be thinking, when you're doing it, be thinking like, oh yeah, you're doing good here. You're doing real good, Michelle, because
sometimes you're like, oh, I'm doing really good, really good. But you still have to think, okay, I still have a minute left. You can't get too overconfident. You know, you have to stay focused.
Right in the
moment. Until the end. That's when you can really let it go. When you're at the ending post and you're like, oh, I'm done.
Thank God I did it. Thank God
done.
I'm still here.
Yeah, exactly.
Now, what about that Tara Lipinski? She's not going to compete anymore.
She's professional.
Yeah. Did you ever feel like, you know, hitting her with a crowbar and breaking her knees or anything?
No.
No?
No.
No? Well, tell us about the special now. And maybe you'll show us one of those deals. Maybe you'll show us one of those SoundCloud jobs.
I'll show you a spin.
You will?
Yeah.
Thank you.
It's too bad you don't have skates on.
Well, I was too afraid because I just know I'd hurt myself. I know I'll crack my head or something. I'm afraid.
No.
Can I just watch, though? Even though I skate when I was a kid, but I hurt myself so many times on ice skates.
My mom actually did one time on a tailbone. She's like, not skating anymore. No more for me.
Yeah. So. There was a big thing in Utah, skating. And I'm on ice rink skating. A lot of people did it where I grew up, and that's why I'm such a fan of it. That's like the part of the Olympics that I'm really, really into, and gymnastics too. So I'm very happy to meet you and want to see you do something cool out there.
Oh, I have
now. What are you doing?
Thing.
Okay, tell me.
We have this harness thing that I can actually fly. So I have a harness around, and it's a sort of belt.
Oh, I flew in the Wizard of Oz. I know all about harnesses.
Yeah. Doesn't it hurt a little bit?
No, because they put this padding in there.
Yeah.
You should get padding.
Okay, I'll ask them for more padding.
Yeah. Foam rubber.
I did the back flips and the front flips, but then it started to hurt. I was like, okay, get me down. Get me down. But I'll show you a...
What are you showing us? A flip?
No.
A spin?
A flying
a
sow camel.
Cow? A flying camel?
Yeah, it sounds harder than it really is, but I'll do a flying camel.
All right, cool. Oh my God, look at that. That's amazing. How do you do that?
Practice. When I learned this, I got really dizzy. And then you just learn how to spot yourself when you're spinning.
Yeah.
So you come out of it and then you know where you're located on the ice surface.
I just love so much because it's what I always suspected, that like about probably 95% of it is mental, huh?
It's all mental.
It's all 100% mental. Oh my God, I just love talking about that. See, I can relate to mental because I'm really mental. We're taking a commercial. We'll come back and talk to Michelle some more. I mean, because it's all mental being a comic. Michelle.
Okay, I'm a little attached.
Okay, that's good. Yeah.
There we go. Okay.
Pretty cool.
I'm free.
Did you get? You didn't get too dizzy, did you?
A little bit when I get out of control. I'm so used to just doing like three rotations and then out. But when I don't have any control, I'm just spinning.
You could just hang there and spin all day if somebody didn't stop you.
Yeah, I was holding on to the wire that I have in it. I don't know where to put my hand.
It's like hard
it's
to
in
learn
the way.
It.
Yeah.
I did it, you know, when I was doing that Wizard of Oz play. And we'd try to direct it and say a line. And it always be out of control, facing the wrong way. And it takes a lot to learn how to control those wires. I wanted to ask you, because I like to ask this question to people who are very successful. because I think it's important for kids to hear it so they can model it. You were 5 years old when you found out that this is what you wanted to do.
Well, I started skating when I was five, and when I was about 7 or 8, I knew for sure I wanted to be a skater because it just hit me like, you know, like wham, and I was like, okay, I love this sport, this is what I want to do, and then I just stuck with it.
Did you know you could do it, or you were...
I fell a thousand times. I still fall all the time, but when I started skating, I had the rail to hold on to, so I wasn't like, oh, I want to be a skater, and I just skated off. There's no way, you know, right. I was walking on the ice, and I was losing my balance, of course. I was holding on to everybody. And it's just
but were you willing, did you make a decision to be willing to pay any price or do anything to get
well,
there?
Well, at first I thought, oh, I'll go to the Olympics, the next Olympics. I watched 88 and thought, okay, I want to be at the Olympics. Wow. And I didn't know how much effort and energy and dedication it is in your sport. I thought, oh, okay, I'll just go to
couple
Olympics.
Hours a day. Yeah,
yeah, just maybe I'll go on the ice and then I'll be world champion. It's not that easy. So if you want to do something, I always encourage the kids, you know, just whatever you want to do, follow it all the way through. Put all of your energy, think about it, live it.
Thank you, Michelle, and look where it got you. You're great. Thank you for letting us come over today.
Oh, you're welcome. I'm glad you came.
Good luck.
Thank you.
And I got a present for you, right? I heard this was your favorite. How cool is this dress? Look at
these.
You got this. Is your favorite candy?
Junior Mints.
You love Junior Mints. It's always
sweet.
Don't forget to eat candy.
Okay,
for
I will.
For those of us who are watching and eat candy too.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Next, we're gonna turn around here. Next, we're going to meet our new domestic goddess. Be right back. Look at our two previous domestic goddesses, Karen Middleton and Edith Kerrigan. Roll that tape. Today we are going to honor a very special mother. This is a surprise because she doesn't know we're doing this, who will become our first domestic goddess on the Roseanne Show. The mother we are honoring did something very, very selfless and incredible. She and her husband had 3 children of their own. And then one evening on the news, they heard about 8 children who were about to be separated into 5 different foster homes. And without giving it even a second thought, they adopted all of those 8 children, making their family of 5 a family of 13. Please welcome our very first domestic goddess inductee, Karen Middleton. Now this incredible woman woke up one morning after her husband had left, and she realized that she had 10 children to raise on her own. Now, this is for real. And without feeling sorry for herself, she worked odd jobs, put her kids through private Catholic school, and still paying off college student loans. She juggled bills to give them Christmas tree and presents every single year, and while working 2 jobs at once, she still found time for PTA and her kids' activities. She still lives in that 3-bedroom, 1-bathroom house that she raised her kids in with 2 kids still at home. This is an incredible woman. Please welcome our new domestic goddess all the way from Philadelphia, Edith Kerrigan. Well, today we're going to honor our third domestic goddess, and her name is Lorna Hawkins. Congratulations. Okay, now are you pretty surprised?
Yes, I am.
Come and sit down here. You have to have your, first of all, here's your flowers.
Okay. Oh, they're beautiful.
Aren't they beautiful? Ooh, show everybody.
Look at
everybody. Here is your, here's your scepter. This is your queenly scepter that voice your decrees with.
Okay. Anyone that makes me upset.
Anybody, yes. This, I think, is your, no, this is your crown. Here's your crown. Put that on your big head. You got a big head. And here is your beautiful, check that out. Isn't that beautiful?
That is cake.
Oh, yeah. There you go. I can get that on there.
You got it?
Yes, ma'am.
All right.
You look beautiful.
Thank you.
Sit down here. Take your throne.
Oh, gosh, I got a chair.
You are a remarkable woman. Everybody, I think we need to stand and pay homage to her.
Okay.
Because she is our domestic goddess.
Thank you.
I like the crown on you. You're looking good.
Thank you.
You are such an incredible example, as well as human being, for somebody who has just gone to the edge of pain and despair and hopelessness,
yes,
and turned it into something that helps a whole bunch of other people, which that is just like the highest thing anybody can ever do in this whole world. And so I'm very glad that you're here. I'd like to talk a little bit about what happened to you.
Okay.
Will you tell us, you were cooking on Thanksgiving.
Yes, I was cooking on Thanksgiving. It was the night before Thanksgiving.
Mm-hmm.
And that was one of my son's favorite time because, you know, I had to cook a lot of food.
Right.
And so I was up until about 8:30. I wanted to get done early for some reason. Usually I'm there till about 12 or 1 o'clock, and it was drizzling that night. And then all of a sudden I heard these gunshots, and they were very loud. And I went to the door, and I could hear my daughter screaming that somebody had shot her brother. And from that point, I just went in and woke my husband up, and we ran around the corner, because this happened around the corner from my house. And when we ran around there, my son was laying down next to his car. And so I just immediately ran, because I didn't hear the ambulance, to get my truck. I had to pick up the truck, still do.
Right.
And we put him in the back, and my husband drove frantically to St. Francis Medical Center, which wasn't very far from the house. And I looked down at my son, and I knew he was dying at that point because blood was coming out of his ears.
How old was he?
21. And so a week later, we pulled him off the respirator because the bullet went into his neck and severed the artery to his brain. And so he was dying from that moment on. And the saddest part about it is, you know, it was four young black men looking for somebody else that came by and shot my son. So it's just...
Drive-by shooting. What happened a few years later? You tell us that.
And then in 1992, I was working, you know, on drive-by agony, just still trying to stop violence, get awareness
right.
out.
You started a whole...
Well, a month after my son was murdered, I went to cable because nobody wanted to listen to what I had to say, and I felt that I needed to talk about it.
Right.
And that somebody needs to listen, the bottom line.
Right.
So I started peace marches in 1990. I thought about these, and as we were preparing for our second peace march, then I thought, you know, life was going to get back to somewhat normal.
Right.
I got a telephone call that my second son was shot by a carjacker, and an hour later...
He was in a phone booth.
He was at a phone booth.
Your second son?
My second son. He was in college at that time, and it took a while for us to get him back on track after his brother died.
Absolutely.
And these two black guys came to him and asked him for his car, and he refused, and they shot him with an AK-47. And an hour later, he died. So now I don't have any more sons.
You have no more sons.
No more sons. But I do have a daughter.
How? You have a daughter?
Mm-hmm.
You have a whole bunch of grandchildren. But how did you get through that? What was it in you, or what was given to you?
Well, you know, at first, it's like you're in a different world. You don't even know you're there, you know?
Right.
But God, he's been very good to me. Even though, you know, some people might say, well, he took God, you know, he didn't take anything from me.
Right, he didn't do it.
He didn't take anything from me. And he's got me still here and helping people. And that's the victory. That's the victory
and
to
you
be able
have,
to help somebody else.
You have affected a huge, huge community.
Yes.
With taking the stuff that happened to you and decided that you're not going to take it anymore. And
right.
You want to do something to stop violence. And particularly drive-by violence. So the organization that you started is, tell us the name.
Drive-by Agony. Because someone drove by my house, murdered my son, and left me in agony.
What did you get from God about what you're supposed to teach people about this thing? What is wrong with us, first of all? What's wrong with us?
Forgiveness. We must learn to forgive one another for the things that we do. We must learn to love one another. Bring back love, peace, respect, those words that are really, really a part of America,
right,
but seem like it's just lost. You know what I'm saying? Forgiveness, it starts with that. It's just the bottom line. Even when you're a very young kid, you should learn how to forgive. So when something tragically happens to you or somebody hurts you, then if you can forgive that, then that means you can go on. You don't have to hurt them back. That's really the bottom line.
We are going to bring out this young man named DeAndre that is a kid that you helped out. Will you come out and talk to us now, DeAndre? Hello. Tell us where you were headed when you were 14 years old.
Place that nobody here would like to see. Me growing up, starting 12, 13.
Had you ever been in jail by the time you were 14?
Too many times. It's like I went to school in jail while I was in high school, because I only was in high school and played sports. Sports was over, back in jail. Nobody in school see me no more, too. Back in the football season. So I used to see Lorna's show.
You had a show on cable.
Still started, do.
Yeah, called Drive by Agony, right? Where you dealt with these issues.
Yes.
This kid saw you.
I didn't even know it.
No, we didn't know.
No idea.
I mean, I never seen her before in my life personally. I just used to see the show.
Tell me how she changed your life.
What she just said, love, care, respect, teaching how to forgive, because I never could, always done things in my past, and a lot of people, my family and friends, didn't forgive me for, and so I had to deal with that, and I had to learn that first, to have to forgive myself for what I did, and if I don't do that, then nobody else will forgive me, so.
Were you just carrying around so much pain and anger inside? Did you just... Or like in a place where you just had to hit out and get something else?
Man, it was so much pain, confusion, trouble, scary, alone, everything, you know. And the young people today, all that is brought to you as soon as you hit the street.
Right.
You get, no matter what kind of household you come from,
that's right.
Once you get onto the street,
right,
if you don't know love, respect, care, forgiveness, you can't make it. I mean, there's no way. And if it wasn't for Miss Hawkins, Lorna, I wouldn't have made it. I wouldn't be here.
You think you wouldn't be alive?
No. I wouldn't be alive. I wouldn't be here. That's it. I would not be here. I'm sure. She taught me how to go out and want things.
Isn't that cool that one woman can do that for, like, I don't know how many people? We're going to bring your husband out, and he's going to talk to us, too. Your husband, Frank.
Yes.
Frank, come on out here.
Party.
Hi, Frank. Hi. Nice to meet you. Tell us what your wife did for you when you went through all this terrible, terrible stuff.
Well, I was pretty angry and upset myself. I guess I thought I might take a different type of approach. I guess I wanted to knock some heads. And
you want to get violent yourself, right?
Right.
I think everybody understands that.
Yeah, but, you know, we had a lot of conversations when this happened, and I looked at more of what she was doing. She had a different approach where she made me realize and see that if I did go out and get violent and start doing things like that, that I'm just like the same guy that killed my son, so I'm sort of in the same bag there, and then I end up hurting someone else's loved one, and I guess that makes me no better than them. I love her very much for what she does. It makes me think that we all of us as humans have to admire this lady, what she does, and somehow or another get involved right. and realize that we can make a difference.
Right. And how has she changed a whole community of people?
Well, to bring more awareness that, you know, if we sit back, then it becomes just right there in front of us. But right. if we step forward, right. then we can put this maybe behind us.
We're going to bring out your daughters and your grandchildren now. You got a whole bunch of grandchildren.
Yes.
Hello. You have a wonderful grandma. You have a wonderful family.
Thank you.
You want to tell us anything about your grandmother? What do you want to say?
She helps people to stop killing.
Doesn't she talk to 150 school children a day?
Yes. Yes.
What do you?
I'm so tired.
What do you say to them?
I tell them about what happened to me. And I also find out how many of them have lost someone, and I find out that far too many of them, sometimes almost all of them have lost.
Oh, my God.
Fathers, uncles, cousins, friends. I also try to get them to open up to me, you know, and talk about what happened to them, because I think it's important. And then we do exercises as well, talking about things that we don't like, things that make us angry. And then we also try to come up with solutions on, like, what we can do about it, you know. And the first thing we can do is forgive each other. And then also learn that violence starts when we're very young. So if we want to see a better world tomorrow, then that means that every last one of us, every last one of them, has to start promoting peace now by stopping the fights and the arguments,
right.
you know, picking on each other, calling right. each other's names, those kind of
right.
things. Because those are the things that start violence.
What happened to just talking to people exactly. and disagreeing?
Right.
What happened to that?
You know,
I'm scared of, that's a lot of why I wanted to do this show, because I'm so scared of how things are now.
And you know what, Roseanne?
What?
I want to thank you. You have no idea.
No, I do. I do.
If more people
Lorna,
like you.
I do
you.
Have an idea. And if more people like you, Lorna.
God bless you.
Stay tuned, because Lorna's life is going to change a little bit. That's right. She's going to get the Roseanne domestic goddess treatment in about 2 minutes. We'll be right back. Lorna Hawkins, who is the founder of Drive-By Agony, and you know, I want to say that you are proof that you show us how, despite tragedy, we can go on and affect the world and still make it a better place, and that's why you honor us by being our domestic goddess. And I want to say, like, DeAndre here is also getting married to your daughter, Francie.
Yes, he is.
Oh! You knew that, right?
Well, I know they alluded to it.
Oh. You didn't know that either? Well, that's your first surprise. Oh, okay. Well, whatever.
Good.
Are you happy about that?
Believe me, I am.
Now get ready, Lorna, because you're going to get the domestic goddess treatment. So we'll spin that turntable. Now, after learning about Ms. Hawkins' ability to turn tragedy into prosperity, Albertsons felt compelled to demonstrate support and encouragement to this wonderful, caring person by donating a great big Christmas banquet dinner for her family and friends to enjoy.
Oh. That's all right.
He's not going to be there, though. Christmas dinner for 25.
All
Albertsons,
right.
pretty cool.
It certainly is.
And Albertsons was touched by the number of victims that Ms. Hawkins' organization, Drive-By Agony, reaches. And to encourage her to continue her efforts to positively impact the lives of a number of victims, Albertsons is donating an IBM 486P66 megahertz computer, 15-inch monitor, keyboard, and mouse. The computer will help drive-by agony create workable databases and teach children basic computer skills.
Yes.
I don't even know how to turn one on, but I hope it does good for you. When Albertson's local store directors heard your incredible story, they began thinking of ways that they can make a difference this holiday season. And after a few phone calls and a couple of shopping trips, Team Albertson's came up with a variety of toys and gifts for the children of Drive-By Agony Help.
Oh, my.
Albertson's got some Christmas presents.
Yes, sir.
Albertsons would like to wish Miss Hawkins and her children a very Merry Christmas and a very Happy New Year.
Oh, thank you, Albertsons.
Thank you, Albertsons.
Yes.
Now, Lorna, we know that you devote so much of your time and energy to the Drive-By Agony, and we also know that you, like so many others, might have some financial concerns at home, especially this time of year, that sometimes makes it difficult for you to keep your focus on victims of gun violence. And to assure that you keep making a difference, the Money Store is going to give you some money.
All right.
The Money Store is giving you a check for $2,500.
All right.
To keep your finances on track so that the work you do can continue.
Oh, well, thank you. Thank
That's
you.
What the Money Store is all about, the Money
all
Store.
Right,
helping
go.
Homeowners lower their monthly expenses to get back on track financially so they can focus on other important things in their lives. The Money Store, 1-800-LOAN-YES.
All right.
And guess what? Well, we always like to have something exciting for our domestic goddesses and their husbands, and the Money Store has helped you out with something else. Along with African travel. You're getting a very special trip. Let's hear those drums, please. I wish I was going. I always wanted to do this. I know you're always wanting to do it, too. You're going on a 13-day safari
right.
to South Africa. How cool is that? Is that cool? You and Frank will fly aboard award-winning South African Airways to Cape Town, the fairest cape in the world. And to begin your exciting safari, you will explore the exotic villages and cultures of Swaziland and then continue on to Zululand and famous Kruger National Park. Truly a once-in-a-lifetime adventure, courtesy of African Travel Incorporated, the nation's leading safari operator. Please welcome Dave Herbert, owner and president of African Travel.
All right.
I'm delighted for you to live your dream and
yes.
give you this trip of a lifetime to Africa.
Thank
Enjoy.
You.
Enjoy.
Thank
Enjoy.
You.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Nice to meet you, Roseanne.
Very nice. Nice to meet you. Woo. Is that cool?
Yes.
13 days.
I love it.
Cool
thing. I need it.
I know you need it. You need a little relaxation in the wild.
Yes. Yeah.
Thank you, Lorna. Take your walk. It's time for your domestic goddess walk. I'm going to go over there and then go back. Stay tuned. When we come back, we have a special Christmas performance for Lorna, her family, and you. Well, Lorna, we have a special holiday treat for you. Every year, a group of pop music's most talented singers gets together and records a holiday album, The Colors of Christmas. And here to sing Born on Christmas Day are Melissa Manchester, Peabo Bryson and Oleta Adams.
One starry night, so bright, the world was filled with love.
A wonderful sight, the light that shined from up above. The angels proclaimed his holy. The King of Kings.
This is the story, power and glory. Three wise men came to play, a guiding star had led the way. There he lay, born on Christmas Day.
It's a special encore presentation of her big premiere on the next Roseanne Show.
Here we are with Peabo. Nice to have you back. You said we beat you up a little bit last time.
You beat up on me big time.
I did not beat up on you.
You talked that lady into beating up on me. She was so sweet at first, and when I was at her house.
You said that I give women too much hope.
You do. You give them too much.
What does that mean?
Not too much hope. Too much courage.
What does that mean, too?
Oh, too much courage. I just think.
He thinks that. Well, she was a little mean to you.
Well, again, I'm outnumbered again. And you're beating up on me.
We love you. Just know.
You think this is fun.
No, we love you. We think you're great. Now, that's not beating up on you.
Well, you get a kiss for that.
Now, tell us about... Woo! Tell us about the tour and the album.
Actually, this is the very first Colors of Christmas CD ever, and it's in your record stores as we speak. Mm-hmm. It's a collage of artists, Oleta Adams, Melissa Manchester, Jeffrey Osborne, Sheena Easton, Peabo Bryson, Philip Bailey, and Roberta Flack.
Oh, the people that have been on the Colors of Christmas tours.
How long have you been doing this tour?
Well, Melissa and I actually did the very first one.
Yeah, this is my fourth year. Wow. This is your fifth year as a tour, but the original Colors of Christmas performance was a concert for UNICEF.
Oh.
Yes.
So now it's a tour.
And you tour all over where? The U.S.?
The U.S.
The whole
and
world?
A little bit of
Canada.
That's cool.
Yeah.
This is your new CD.
Yes, that is my Christmas CD, Joy. Christmas? Thank you.
Good stuff.
You guys, it's your second time here, so I'm glad you're back.
Thank you.
And it's your first time here, so I'm glad you're here.
Thank you. It's great being here.
Oleta Adams, what made you decide to join up with this tour?
Well, they asked me to be a part of this halfway through this year, and I thought, well, this is exciting. I don't have to sing so much that I ruin my voice, and we get a chance to travel around and help people to get the spirit of Christmas. That brings me a lot of joy, a lot of joy. And it's wonderful to see people all dressed up, and they bring their entire families, and it's just singing good songs, songs that you're familiar with as well. Well, all songs that you're familiar with.
Christmas songs are the best songs, though, huh?
Aren't they? And I get to sing some of the greatest ones.
Like, what's your favorite one to sing?
I get to sing Nat King Cole's Chestnuts Roasting on an Open Fire.
That's the best one.
You know,
I sang it last year, but it's a man thing. I got bashed again.
That's a man thing. There
are you getting picked on by two men?
I'm getting picked on. I'm sorry. Yeah. I'm getting picked on.
I would think that women would be throwing themselves at your feet.
Well, I didn't say that women didn't throw themselves at my feet.
But that's not enough for you. You what?
No, it's not enough for me. I want more. I want more.
What more could you possibly want?
He wants to actually throw food groups at him, I guess. I don't know.
See, this is the bashing. It starts again. You guys, they're ganging up on me. You see it for yourselves. And you're right here.
Should we all go, oh, Peabo. We love you. Now, be quiet.
I love you right back. See?
Be quiet
yes,
or I'll
ma'am.
Slap you.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Thank you, Peabo, Melissa, and Oleta for being here on the show.
Thank you.
We'll be right back.